Hello everyone, I'm Alberto De Conti. I represent the Rudolf Group as Head of Marketing and Fashion Division, and I'm based in Milan. I am very excited about being here today, and I would like to thank Transformance ED for the opportunity being given to us once again. Today, we will be talking about chemistry in denim processing, or some of it, as we will need like 15 days rather than 15 minutes to talk about it all. Okay, let me try and share my screen. This is always a little bit the critical moment in all Zoom presentations. Here we go. Let me try first to introduce the company or the companies, if you like. So both the Rudolf Group and Hub 1922. So the Rudolf Group, which you see in the two pictures above, is a leading manufacturer of chemical auxiliaries that sees itself as a global service provider for the whole textile industry. Over 1,400 employees worldwide, 1,400 in Gera Street, Germany, of which 85 are in R&D, and they work at developing innovative, responsible solutions. The core competence of Rudolf is functional and performance chemistry for textiles. On the two pictures before, below, you see Hub 1922, which is where I am right now. And it's the new kid on the block. It's based in Milan. It's the design and development center of the group and centers of excellence, if you like, dedicated to garment processing and denim. Our mantra is German engineering and Italian style. And we work with designers and product developers worldwide to turn conscious chemistry into a meaningful fashion propositions. Now, let's now start talking about the traditional historical denim washing process. When I began my career back in 1993, the process was quite basic and mainly composed by three phases. There was some process to apply local abrasion that you see on the left of the screen, a stone washing step in the middle, and some bleaching to get a lighter shade and softening at the end. Because in the days, local abrasion was mainly done by either sandblasting, which was banned because of concern about silicosis or manual scraping, the possibilities were limited in terms of chemistry. There was actually no need for chemistry. Those were the days when chemistry started to be increasingly used in industrial laundries, and when very wrong mindset started to develop, if you ask me. In fact, as long as you were inside the premises of the chemical manufacturer, the products, the chemical products, were handled with care and with all precautions. As soon as the very same chemical auxiliaries entered the laundry, all the care was lost and best practices were forgotten. And the situation hasn't completely improved everywhere yet. So look at this video, for example. This is actually fairly recent, not 30 years ago. The two poor operators don't have any personal protection equipment. There is no proper spray cabinet, and it's just a hole in the wall that evacuates the fumes. This is clearly not a responsible way of working. And unfortunately, it is more the norm than the exception in some part of the world still. To those of you who are studying and are going to be the future of this industry, then please remember, as a general rule, chemical must not be randomly sprayed. If they're sprayed, there must be appropriate equipment or a closed system. Now, let's stop talking about the past and the problems that we inherited from a previous generation, and let's look into the future. Today, we still find the three steps, so local abrasion, stone washing, and other treatments, but the situation is very different. Local abrasion, when it comes to local abrasion, denim lasering certainly is the dominant technology out there, and the current best alternative to some chemical spraying. I'm sure that others during these 3 days will provide you with some insights about denim lasering. Stone washing, the amount of pumice stones used in modern stone washing is being reduced thanks to biotechnology. And then softening, softeners are no longer just about, you know, conferring softness and smooth handle. Today, they can improve abrasion resistance, solubility, resistant to yellowing, and more. So they are really becoming functional finishes. So talking about local abrasion, the first one of the three blocks, we said lasering is of fundamental and paramount importance. Today, so-called laser boosters significantly improve the laser fading obtaining. These formulations are studied and perfected so that when applied to the garments before lasering, they enhance the action of the laser, make the process even faster, and decrease the brown, yellow cast linked to cotton burning. And you see examples on the left side of the screen. Because they are very effective and powerful, they can, however, blur the image, being marked denim less real, less natural. The latest innovation that we have launched as a company this year, and that is becoming increasingly successful, is what we call laser smoother. That is a formulation very easy to pre-apply to garments before laser burning, and that returns a very natural image. Now, I'm not saying this to promote the products, okay? But to show the ongoing intimate collaboration with technology manufacturers and how sophisticated chemical R&D can be. After local abrasion, we said there is stonewashing. And let's see what has happened to modern stonewashing. Although it is the most iconic operation in denim finishing, traditional stonewashing with pumice stones has a number of shortcomings. So you can see them listed here on the slide. So it's very expensive, it requires a lot of labor, it can damage the metal parts on the garments, you know, and the fabric performance, the quality can be impacted. Biotechnology has significantly helped stonewashing, and the number of enzymes, those are molecules called cellulases, that are catalysts in the sense that they accelerate the hydrolysis, meaning the cutting of cotton fibers, are today available for modern stonewashing. Cellulases that come from naturally selected microorganisms rather than genetically modified ones. They have the reduction, and in some cases, the complete elimination of pumice stones. Modern cellulases work at ambient temperature and neutral pH, which I'm sure you know it's 7. In terms of other supporting chemistry, let's talk about softeners for a second. The most commonly used softeners are fatty acid condensation products and silicones. Silicones are mostly used in textiles as softeners or functional additions. I'm getting technical now, but please, you know, bear with me. The building blocks in the synthesis of silicones and byproducts of the same process are the so-called cyclic siloxanes, very complicated. They are also called cyclics, and those are the three molecules that I'm showing on screen here. In 2018, cyclics, also known as D4, D5, and D6, as you see here, have been included in as substances of very high concern. That means you don't want to have them in the final products. Best-in-class products, best-in-class silicones, have less than 150 ppm in the formulation, which is very, very little. And you need advanced and very expensive manufacturing plants to strip down cyclics to the very low level. We analyzed some common silicones in the market, and we found up to 5% of cyclics, which is enormous. And you don't want to have them in your textiles. Those are examples of stupid chemistry. Stupid chemistry is cheap chemistry. It's byproducts, basically waste of other industries. And that's what is given chemistry a bad name. It's inexpensive commodity chemicals that can be sourced from other industry, such as metal processing in refineries, coal burning, power plant, et cetera, et cetera. The problem with them is that they can contain the so-called unintentionally added substances, contaminants of diverse nature, and in some cases, that's trouble. Therefore, when you guys will be in a position to purchase chemical auxiliaries, please be careful at what you buy. Let's conclude with functional chemistry. That is performance chemistry, difficult to see on denim pre-COVID, but now definitely more accepted. In this case, we see water repellency being applied to denim. Using biomimicry, and that is the study and replica of natural models, the industry has developed sophisticated ecological sustainable systems that enable durable water repellency for textiles and that contain no persistent chemistry. Once applied, this chemistry doesn't affect neither the overall look nor the end feel of our beloved denim. And you see two examples on the slide here. Then, same story goes for textile treatments capable of stopping the proliferation of bacteria and viruses. Those applications prevent infections in clinics and hospitals and control odor-causing bacteria. Again, while pre-COVID it was very difficult to talk about this functionality in denim, now it's becoming way more accepted. Some of these best-in-class treatments, originally developed for antimicrobial treatment in hospital sheets, have been engineered for high wash durability, and that is more than 100 washes at high temperature, like 80 degrees. So basically they are a thermal on denim. To conclude, chemistry is a key foundation of life. There is no product that has not been impacted by it in some way. Therefore, the central question is not if, but how is chemistry involved in modern society and business? The combination of modern real science and environmental consciousness leads to what we at Rudolf call aspirational chemistry, something unique and something that positions best-in-class organizations as shiny example and guiding lights throughout the industry. By 2030, we aim for a significant fraction of our products to be either sourced through parts alternative to the traditional petrochemicals or by upcycling waste and or other byproducts from other industries. This is the vision, and this is where we think the future is going. I really hope these few minutes we spent together were informative and up to your expectations. So now, in case you have any questions, please let me know.